My name is Sean. I am the pastor of student ministries here at Emergence Church. You know, the other day, all three of my kids, they kind of went off on their own little adventures, whether it was riding bikes with friends, going to the local park, or just hanging out in the neighborhood. And as each one of my kids left, I gave them that common refrain that parents give their kids thousands of times over the years. Be careful. See, the weight of those words is so much heavier now than they were even just a few years ago. Our kids are getting older and they're becoming more independent. And so as parents, it's a stressful transition. But we have to trust that they're going to make the right choices and pray over them and pray for them when they're not with us. I can just imagine that the Apostle Paul was feeling some of the same angst as he had to quickly leave a group of new believers at Thessalonica as they faced some fierce opposition and a lot of hostility. And so if you have your Bibles, you can open up to Acts chapter 17, which is where we're going to be today, and we're going to read through verses 1 through 9. It says this, verse 1, Paul and his companions, when they had come to Thessalonica, where there was a Jewish synagogue, as was his custom, Paul went into the synagogue, and on three Sabbath days he reasoned with them from Scripture, explaining and proving that the Messiah had to suffer and rise from the dead. This Jesus I am proclaiming to you is the Messiah, he said. Some of the Jews were persuaded and joined Paul and Silas, as did a large number of God-fearing Greeks and quite a few prominent women. But other Jews were jealous. So they rounded up some bad characters from the marketplace, formed a mob, and started a riot in the city. They rushed to Jason's house in search of Paul and Silas in order to bring them out to the crowd. But when they did not find them, they dragged Jason and some of the other believers before the city officials, shouting, "These men who have caused trouble all over the world have now come here, and Jason has welcomed them into his house. They are defying Caesar's decree and saying there is another king, one called Jesus." When they heard this, the crowd and the city officials were thrown into turmoil. Then they made Jason and the others postpone and let them go. See, Paul wasn't with this group very long, maybe 3 weeks. But he had reasoned from Scripture and shared Jesus in such a clear, convincing, and convicting manner that a large number of Jews, Greeks, and prominent women had accepted Jesus as their Savior. They moved from darkness into light. They moved from death to life. They were condemned sinners that had now become forgiven saints. And they're, you know, Paul's feeling an angst that as he had to quickly leave, that would their faith really stick? Would it be genuine enough to withstand the hostility and just the opposition that they were going to face? What we do know from a letter that Paul would later write to them is that their faith was genuine. And not only was it genuine, it produced a passion and it produced a perseverance that even today as believers, we can look to as an example to follow. And so if we, you know, look over at 1 Thessalonians, it says this, we can know that they had a passion. We know that they wanted to see the gospel advance. They didn't want to just keep it in Thessalonica. They wanted to see it go out. They wanted to see other people know and hear the message of Jesus. Then Paul writes to them in 1 Thessalonians chapter 1, verse 7 and 8. It says, "And so you became a model to all the believers in Macedonia and Achaia. The Lord's message rang out from you, and your faith in God has become known everywhere." See, their faith was so genuine, it produced a passion that they wanted to see the gospel advance. But as we all know, when you preach the gospel, when you share the message of Jesus, and you look to, you know, advance it, you're going to get some different reactions, right? I mean, generally, I've seen three different types of reactions to the message of Jesus. One of anger, one of apathy, and one of acceptance. Now, we know there was a group of people, you know, at Thessalonica that accepted it. But there was also that group that they were angry, right? They were angry toward the message. They were angry toward the messengers. They created a riot. They fell into turmoil. And that required a genuine faith from this young group of believers that required perseverance. And we know from Paul's letter to them that that's exactly what was produced in them, because right before that, in verse 6, it says, "You became imitators of us and of the Lord, for you welcomed the message in the midst of severe suffering with joy given by the Holy Spirit." So they accepted this in the midst of hostility and anger and adversity, but they accepted it with such a joy that it allowed them to continue to persevere beyond all of that. And so needless to say, it's a good reminder, an example for us to follow even today, even in this year of 2020, as we look out at our contemporary culture and see all the different things that are going on. It's a good reminder for us that we need to have a steadfast resolve of perseverance and passion for the gospel, for Jesus. And as we look out at our culture, we have to be reminded that our hope is in Jesus Christ. And because of that, we can passionately advance the gospel. We can persevere through any adversity that we face, despite the circumstances, despite a pandemic, despite riots, despite everything that we have seen and faced this year. I'm sure Paul's heart ached for the believers of the Thessalonica, and he probably even wanted to say, "Be careful." But if I can paraphrase the beginning of his letter to them, it probably would sound a little bit more like, "Be careful. Allow your work to be produced by faith. Be careful to allow your labor to be produced by love. Be careful. Allow your endurance to be inspired by hope, all in our Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ." Guys, have a great rest of the week, and may you and your family have a joyous holiday season. Merry Christmas, everybody.